In the last video, we looked at how to create and collect an accounts receivable. But how do we value them as a company? What do we mean by valuing accounts receivable? Well, remember, we may sell an account with the intent to fully collect the receivable, but does that always happen? Well, of course not. There will be times when we cannot collect the receivable. So what do we do? So this unit is going to focus on uncollectible accounts. Anytime you sell on account, there is the possibility that our customer will not pay that balance. And different reasons why, but it happens. It's just a risk we take. The business generated from offering credit far exceeds the cost of actual bad debts to our company, as long as we use some good credit practices. So now we know there's three possibilities. We sell on account, so either the customer can return the goods, which we looked at in the last video, the customer can pay the balance due, or what happens if the customer doesn't pay us at all. So let's look at uncollectible accounts. There are two methods that we have for handling uncollectible accounts. There's the direct write-off method, which only records bad debt expense once the account is fully deemed uncollectible. So in other words, we can sell the, or we have generated the account receivable at any point in time, but until we 100% are sure that they're not going to pay, or at least as sure as we can be, there's no such thing as 100%, but once we get to the point where we're like, yeah, this customer is not going to pay this debt, at that point in time, we would actually recognize bad debt expense. Now the other method is the allowance method. The allowance method records bad debt expense in the same period as the sales that created the receivable, even if the account hasn't quite been or hasn't made it to the point where it is deemed uncollectible. We go ahead and record that bad debt expense in the same period as the sale, and then we will write it off later. Based on the explanations above, which method do you believe is Gaap? Now remember, Gaap from our last accounting class stands for Generally Accepted Accounting Principles. They are issued standards by typically the FASB, Financial Accounting Standard Board, so there are other sources of Gaap. So Gaap, Generally Accepted Accounting Principle. Which of those two methods do you believe is generally accepted? Well, to answer this, you must look at the matching principle in accounting. Does anyone remember what this principle states? Well, the matching principle states that expenses must be recorded in the same period they generated revenues. So, does that help you determine which method is considered Gaap? Well, the allowance method is considered Gaap because bad debt expense is actually created the moment we sell the goods on account. And the allowance method, even if the account hasn't been deemed uncollectible, we go ahead and we estimate all the expense for that year and we go ahead and book it on the books. So, while the appropriate method is the allowance method, some companies may use the direct write-off method if they have immaterial bad debts or if they do not have to follow Gaap. Remember, the only companies that are 100% bound by Gaap are our public companies. The small mom-and-pop companies do not necessarily follow Gaap. Now, if they want crediting, a bank may require Gaap-approved financial statements, but they, on a day-to-day basis, typically do not have to follow Gaap. With this in mind, let's look at both methods, starting with the direct write-off method. So on October 1st, 2013, Ross Company sold $1,000 on account to GC Company. On February 1st, the account was deemed uncollectible and was written off. Ross Company uses the direct write-off method to account for bad debts. Record the October 1st, any year-end adjustments needed on December 31st, and the write-off on February 1st. So on October 1st, we've got our creation. We sold $1,000 on account to GC Company. So we would need to debit our accounts receivable. We're creating the receivable on our books for $1,000. Then when we sell goods or services, remember that is revenue, so we're going to call this sales revenue. And we record that for $1,000 as well. All right, now this company uses the direct write-off method. So remember, under the direct write-off method, there are no year-end adjustments. We only record the bad debt for this when it's physically deemed uncollectible. So we look forward, there would be no entry on December 31st. All right, so let's look at February 1st then. We actually deem this account uncollectible, so we do not expect to collect any funds and we write off the account. Under the direct write-off method, we recognize bad debt expense at the moment it is deemed uncollectible. So we would debit our bad debt expense account here for the amount of the account. In this case, it was $1,000. And then we would credit our accounts receivable. Once you write off an account, it's not collectible, so we go ahead and take that off our books. Okay? So that's the example of the direct write-off method. Now notice why this method is not considered Gaap. When did this account create revenues? Well, it created revenue in 2013. When did we physically write it off? Well, 2013, we did not write off the account until 2014. So we have revenues generated in 2013. We're not recognizing the expense until 2014. Notice that's not the matching principle. The matching principle says we have to recognize the expense in the same period that the revenues are generated, which means we needed to recognize some kind of expense in 2013 in order for this to be Gaap. So let's move on to the allowance method and let's see how the allowance method is different. Well, again, on October 1st, Ross Company sold $1,000 on account to GC Company. Let's just stop there for a second. Remember, we've already recorded this as debit to accounts receivable for $1,000, and we credited sales revenue for $1,000. On February 1st, the account was deemed uncollectible and was written off. Ross Company uses the allowance method to account for bad debts and estimated $2,000 in bad debts at the end of 2013. Record the October 1st, any year-end adjustments needed on December 31st, and the write-off on February 1st. Now, we've already recorded the October 1st because we knew that transaction from the last problem here we did. Now we need to look at the allowance method. The allowance method states that we must do the year-end accrual and recognize the bad debt expense in the same period as all the sales that generated it. So what we have to do is we have to estimate our bad debts here. Now, you don't know the exact accounts yet. So we have to estimate. We say, okay, based on all of our sales or all of our receivables, this is what I think our bad debt will be for the year. And we go ahead and record that. And in this case, they estimated that $2,000 in bad debts are expected. So at the end of the year, we would go ahead and recognize bad debt expense. And we would recognize it for the amount we estimated. Then we would credit not the accounts receivable because we are not writing off any accounts. We're simply estimating so that we match expenses in the same period as revenue. So we hit a holding account or a contra asset account called the allowance for doubtful accounts. Again, this is a contra account. It's a contra asset. On the balance sheet, this actually nets with the accounts receivable. We'll talk more about that in a later lecture. All right, and we would hit the allowance for $2,000. So basically, we're saying we expect bad debt expense to be $2,000 for the entire year. Now, remember, the October 1st was just one sale. This estimate would be for the entire year of 2013. Now, when we get to the write-off, it's a little bit different too, because on February 1st we write off the account. We've already recognized the expense associated with all those 2013 sales. So when we write off an account from 2013, we're going to go in and not hit bad debt expense. We're going to pull it from that contra account, that holding account, if you want to call it that, that we placed it in, and we're only going to pull out the $1,000 that we've deemed uncollectible to this point. And then we're going to credit the accounts receivable to show that that account is no longer a collectible account. Okay? So notice the difference. This is Gaap because it matches. Keep in mind, when we look at this allowance method, though, the allowance is estimated. And we are going to look at, in a later lecture, I think lecture 3, we're going to look at how we estimate that bad debt expense for the year. There is a rhyme or reason to that $2,000. But for now, I just want you to see the differences. Direct write-off, notice we recorded the receivable. Nothing else was done until we physically wrote it off, which can create mismatched revenues and expenses. Here, we created the sale, and we estimated our entire bad debt for the year, and we've recorded it. It is better to have an expense, even though it is an estimate, and match those with the anticipated expenses than it is to leave nothing at all. Okay? All right. So let's look at a summary of the entries we've done so far. Remember, we got two methods, direct write-off and an allowance method. For the creation of accounts receivable, remember, that's when we sold those goods or services, we always debited accounts receivable, and we always credited the revenue, whether it was sales revenue or it could be service revenue, depending on the type of company. Now, creation of receivables is the same. The method, direct write-off versus allowance, is only applicable to how we treat bad debts. The creation of an account receivable is the same no matter which method. Now, how do we collect it? Well, remember, when we collected the receivable, we collected the cash, and we credited the accounts receivable account. Again, the method here is for bad debt, so it has no bearing on the collection. Here's where we notice the difference. When we wrote off the account, under the direct write-off method, we debited the bad debt expense. We only recognized the expense when we physically wrote off the account, and at that time, we removed it from accounts receivable. Well, under the allowance method, we have already recognized the expense, so we pull it from the allowance for doubtful accounts here, and we credit the accounts receivable. Of course, the dollar amount depends on the transaction, but this is general rule. Now, year-end adjustments. At the end of the year for the direct write-off, there is no adjustment because we only recognize bad debt when we write it off. The allowance method, we do have a year-end adjustment. Remember, at the end of the period, that's when we recognize the bad debt expense using an estimate, and we credit the placeholder, that contra account called allowance for doubtful accounts. And I just noticed I left the word accounts off up here, so let's get that in. All right, so that concludes the second Chapter 9 lecture. Feel free to watch these lectures as many times as you need to help you understand the material. If you have any questions, let me know.